CityWorks Expo is a collaborative, co-creative, and multidisciplinary idea exchange and festival conference that happens each fall in Roanoke, Virginia. By day, attendees are immersed in thought-provoking presentations, riveting performances, and engaging dialogue. By night, the conference continues with after-hours networking opportunities during street festivals, parties, and musical events. To learn more about Expo, visit cityworksexpo.com. Expo 2014 was made possible by these fine sponsors.
I am an Arizona State Senator, but I would really appreciate if you didn't hold that against me. I'm not really like what you would hear about on the Colbert Report and things like that. I actually have a lot of titles. I only moonlight as a state senator. I'm actually a public artist as my main career. I'm also a graphic designer, small business owner, father of two teenage daughters, social entrepreneur, cultural developer, a whole lot of other things. But the thing that really ties together everything that I do throughout and have done throughout my life is my desire to build community in some form, pretty much in all of its forms. And building community is a tough thing. Now, I'm going to talk to you primarily about something I did to build community in Tucson that opened up this last July, which is a modern streetcar system. And I don't just like modern streetcars because I'm a nut about trains. I really believe that good public transit is key to helping rebuild our civil society, particularly in a time when we're increasingly polarized from one another. Because if you think about it, when you're getting from A to B, the chances are you're driving these days. And if you're driving, the chances are you're driving alone. And when you're driving alone, everyone else is just in your way. It doesn't matter how nice you are. It really doesn't. You're just trying to get from A to B. They're just these faceless people, and you'd rather they be out of your way. But when you're in a light rail vehicle, a modern streetcar, a bus, you're all going in the same direction. You're all going to get there at the same time. You're going to run into somebody you don't know or somebody you didn't expect to meet. You're going to have a conversation, and your whole community becomes a little bit tighter. And that's what we want. That's part of why now we don't even sit down together and watch the evening news together like we did in the 70s. We're watching our own news that we already agree with. And we don't even have the same vocabulary anymore. So I think this is, it's key. What we're doing here is key to doing so many things to rebuild society. And I am so darned excited about the things that have happened already this weekend. I mean, just over at lunch, I was getting so pumped about the idea about how community source capital could unleash our retirement savings, hundreds of billions of dollars that are currently locked up in Wall Street, and we could reduce the power of big money that way by taking our money out of Wall Street and putting it into Main Street. And that could help our democracy and somebody, okay, anyway, I'm going on. Anyway, all this stuff takes patience. And let's start off with where Tucson came from. 1854, this map, I told you it would take patience. It's the beginning of the story. This is just 2 years after Tucson became part of the United States. It was part of the Gadsden Purchase. It's right down there in the southern part. And it actually went back a lot further than that. We have the oldest continuously settled downtown in the country. The Hohokam peoples lived there. I've actually done some archaeological digs in City Hall and gone down and found a 750-year-old Hohokam pot broken in place. It's amazing the kind of layers of history we've seen. This is the first map of downtown Tucson. It was done in 1862 when Arizona was actually both a member of the CSA and the USA. It's a complicated story I won't go into here. But a union officer drew this map, and you can see the basic form of it is it's concentrated. It's kind of a nice city. It's very small. Everything's around that area. This is some of the pictures of what it looked like at the time. This is actually a public art project I did. As an aside, the Bishop of Tucson invited me to do this when they reinterred some graves that were dug up when they did a project downtown where they thought in 1904 they'd move the graves. They'd actually just move the gravestones. So they found all these people, and they had to be reburied. So I used my tile process to find photographs from the 1870s in downtown Tucson that might have been these people and put them in a whole display around where they were reburied in the southeast part of town. This is generally what Tucson looked like. That's the urban form. Sort of one story. It's a Spanish colonial village type of thing. It's mostly made of adobe. It's all local stuff. And then by the 1890s, it looked a lot different. Notice you've got the nicely carved Italian stonework over there. You've got two stories. You've got a lot of timber buildings. You've got a lot of things that are very different. So what happened? This happened. In 1880, March 20th, we got our first train. Now, that was a bit of that first map that I showed you at the beginning. Those little lines, they were drawn on there in 1854, 2 years after they came to the country, were already train lines that they had planned, because what eventually became Southern Pacific wanted a completely weatherproof southern route to get goods across the country. But that brought in a whole lot of things from the east and a whole lot of different changes in how our urban form was created. This is 1916. You see that where that bouncing arrow went? That's a streetcar. We got our first streetcar, it was horse-drawn, in 1897. By 1906, we'd moved to electric streetcars. And you can see the whole town had been moved up, and all this sort of easternization had come in and changed what we looked like as a city. Now, this is 1929. The streetcars were still out there on the street. The city had still gone around. But by 1930, December 31st, we got rid of our original electric streetcar in favor of what became increasingly a sprawling area. And part of that was because our civic boosters, were really interested in bringing people to Tucson, and they were talking about our climate, they were talking about the health, and we got a lot of health exiles. People who were living in New York or Chicago or in anywhere in the East Coast cities suffering from tuberculosis, they were told by their doctors, you got to get out of here, you got to go somewhere hot and dry. And that really started populating us massively. And you see by the 50s, there's our sort of sprawling form, very different from that 1862 map you saw. Another thing that brought people to Tucson was World War II. A lot of troop trains came through. We had Davis-Monthan Air Force Base, and a lot of the troop trains, which came forth every day, twice, three times a day, they got out on Congress Street in downtown Tucson, they saw it, and they remembered, and they came back and moved there afterwards. This is sort of booming Congress Street in 1942. As an aside, this is a cover of a book that I wrote that was a history of downtown Tucson. I worked with low-income kids to get stories from their elders that spun off of a public art project you'll see later. But this gives you a sense of just how great and vibrant downtown was at that time. It was the center. We hadn't yet gone out to the full-on sprawl stuff yet, but everyone was there, everything was there, community was built there. By the 70s to the 90s, as was the story in so many places in this country, the downtown got hollowed out and everybody moved out to the suburbs. It became a car-based city, a classic sprawling western car-based city, and this is what downtown looked like in 1998. It basically looked bombed out disaster zone. Nobody was going down there. People were afraid of going down there. You only went down there if you had jury duty. That's the way it operated. In 1999, I did a mural project. I will tell you more about this later, but this is just a little preview of it. I invented a way for putting photographs on glazed ceramic tiles, but these photographs were taken by street photographers that worked the downtown streets from the 30s to the 50s. Some of the elders that I'd had the teenagers interview on a history of 8 of the West Side barrios in Tucson, they brought in these photographs. They're little postcards, and I loved them. You can see the heroic nature of these everyday people walking through a vibrant downtown dominated by pedestrians. That was the subtext of the whole thing. This is what pedestrian life can bring to a downtown, and we've been there before. Let's go back to our history and figure that out. It's really been embraced by people. That was the entire front cover of the Arizona Daily Star, the Morning Daily, the day after the dedication. They gave it over to that, and I loved that headline because that, to me, is the purpose of public art, is to reflect the best hopes of the community. And it clearly worked in this case. After I did that public art, I started working with a small group of people to push for better public transit, as I told you before, because that's another aspect of building community that I felt was really important. And it took 15 years, basically, to get this done, but we have this done, and this is what we're talking about. Let me tell you about the route itself. It's a 4-mile route. It basically goes between the main connectors it chooses is that blue area is the downtown area, and the orange area is the University of Arizona. So that's the primary areas it serves, but it serves a lot of areas in between it. This is another way of looking at the same thing. You've got the University Medical Center on one end, University of Arizona, and goes right through the campus. You've got the main gate retail district that's a great shopping district, Fourth Avenue, which is home of the nation's largest street fair. You've got the Congress Street District, which was that bombed out zone that has now come back in incredible ways since the streetcar has been built. You've got the Tucson Convention Center, and that area actually was the urban renewal zone, which I'll talk about that more later. We heard about that this morning. And then over to the Mercado Mixed Use District, which was used to be the city garbage dump, which is also on the predominantly Latino West side. I-10, we'll show you this one. This is another way of looking at the entire route. The yellow is the route. I-10 that goes right through the middle of it. When that was put in the late 50s, early 60s, it divided the predominantly Latino West side from the predominantly Anglo East side. A huge gash in our community fabric. This is the first project to ever build a new bridge over that divide. And it's literally, there's actually a dry river that didn't used to be dry called the Santa Cruz that there's a bridge over it. It's the first bridge built on the Santa Cruz since I-10 divided the community, which has had tremendous community building and almost spiritual implications for the community and how we feel about ourselves. So that whole area is being redeveloped, and it's right next to the predominantly Medicaid-served hospital in the area as well. Goes through the convention center, which used to be a community that was the original community in Tucson. There was original photographs that I showed you from the 1870s were taken there. That was the urban renewal zone, predominantly Latino area. And as an aside, again, because of what I heard this morning, I wanted to go through the hope. There was a Hope 6 project, a federal HUD project, where those people originally were moved into public housing, and the public housing became one of those zones that self-created its own problems, and then the Hope 6 project came up with that. And I actually worked with teenagers, or mentions that teenagers were really interested in their history, who came to me after that Snapped on the Street book and said, we'd love to do a history of our projects before they tear them down. That was a fascinating project too, but in the interest of going further, there's the downtown area, goes through there, and some of the areas it goes past. Then it goes up the Fourth Avenue area, goes through the University of Arizona, and ends up at the University Medical Center on the other side. Here's some then and now pictures, which really shows really graphically how successful this has been in transforming the economy and the community. This is a postcard from 1920. There's the original streetcar in the middle of it. On the left there is Hotel Congress, and the Hotel Congress, notice there, before I go to the next after picture, that has three stories. It has two stories now, because in 1934, the third story burned down in a fire, and when one of the firemen noticed that a few of the guests were very nervous about these big, heavy trunks they were trying to carry down, they got a little suspicious, opened them up, and found $23,000 in cash and a bunch of Tommy guns. Turned out it was the Dillinger gang, and we in Tucson caught John Dillinger when no one else could on that day, 1934, on the third floor of that hotel. And there across the street is the Rialto Block, their first theater in town, the Rialto Theater. Now look at this and look carefully. That's the same scene today. We brought it back with the streetcar coming back again. There's the two-story Congress Hotel. There's the Rialto Block there, and there's all sorts of student housing that has popped up in the area. We've got 2,500 new units of student housing constructed in that area, which has helped inject massive life into the downtown area. This is some of the stuff that's going on. There's a building. There was the Montgomery Ward in 1931. By 2009, it looked like this. This was a former Walgreens, and we had that crazy period in the 1950s and 60s where we just covered up beautiful things with blank walls. And now it's been restored like that because the streetcar came and allowed people to want to reclaim historical areas. This is the Rialto Block. There it is in 1936. This is by 2002, the Rialto Theater had reopened. That was its marquee. I don't know if you can see, it says Nightmare on Congress, and Congress Street is where it's at, which was kind of appropriate. By 2014, they got a real marquee, and the entire building had built in, and the entire upstairs that had been abandoned for decades is now this incredible co-working space that looks like Google headquarters. It's just a massively wonderful location. You can see the student housing in the background. This one is so neat, I just wanted to show you. 2008, it's still bombed out, full of graffiti. 2014, it's full of life and people and entertainment and restaurants. There's five restaurants and a couple of bars on the bottom floor now. and people are creating the new industries that will push Tucson forward on the top. This was the old 4th Avenue underpass that connected Congress Street with 4th Avenue. It was dark, it was scary, and it smelled like urine. It was not a good connector, to say the least. This is what it looks like today. We've completely rebuilt it so you can go in and out. It still has a lot of the architectural things inside that harken back to what it was, and the streetcar goes in and out of this, and this is one of those ways you can connect people through underpasses. The Hotel Congress itself, I told you about it before, that's what it looked like in 1936. It's one of the great success stories of downtown, although it was there before the streetcar when it was brought back. This is what it looks like today. It's one of the hottest night spots in Arizona. Richard and Shayna Osseron. Richard is an attorney. Shayna, his wife, they invested in it before anyone else was investing in downtown. And we've really rebuilt that eastern end of downtown around their success. Great music, great food, all sorts of great things there. This is another nice one there. That building there was an adjunct of a federal courthouse, a couple of empty buildings there, and then a vacant lot in 2009. Here we are today. This is now the upper three stories are loft spaces that are privately owned market rate. The bottom three floors are office spaces. Next to it is a really hip restaurant called Panka that has the best cocktails in town. And then there's another corporate headquarters there, the Providence Corp does a Medicaid funding. And then right behind it is the Tucson Electric Power headquarters. They consolidated to be downtown on the streetcar line. It's a LEED Platinum building they just built there. Another little corner, it's real broken down there. Now it's the playground and hub. A guy named Cade Mislinski came in, reclaimed the entire area, and honored the historic bones of it in order to make this happen. This is the same block in 1998, and after the streetcar, it's hopping at night, it's hopping during the day, it's hopping everything. Hub is the best ice cream in town if you come to Tucson. This is another view down that block, 1998, where you had boarded up places, you had a couple of like secondhand clothing stores and antique stores, you actually still had phone booths. And this is the same view today. Pizzeria Bianco is, New York Times says, the number one pizza place in the country. They had one branch in Phoenix, and he was being begged by anybody to go anywhere in the country, Chris Bianco, the owner, and he decided to open up on Congress Street and the streetcar line in Tucson because of its mixture of history and authenticity. And that's that, I loved it when he heard that, because that's what it's about. That's what we're trying to do, is honor our history and keep authenticity as we grow our community. This is just some of the stuff that's happened around there. There's some Pizzeria Bianco, that's the Rosa. It has smashed up Arizona pistachios on top of it, and it's amazing. So if you get that one, if you can get in, because it's always a line, the wait is like an hour and a half on that one. This is some of the new development that's happened. That's new senior housing that was built for low-income senior housing that's on one end of it. And that's student housing that's grown up near the U of A. 525 new units in those high-rises that now help neighborhoods that are historic neighborhoods from getting mini dorms being put into place and really interrupting the fabric of those communities. Interestingly, even though those are seniors in college living there, there are senior citizens wanting to get in there also because of the proximity of the streetcar. So I kind of like the idea of the Elder Hostel meets Animal House being brought to you by transit-oriented development. Imagine the parties that can go on there. And there's some more projects from downtown. That's one of the market rate lofts that's been built there, and the One North Broadway one on that side. And up on this one, that was senior public housing, that unit right there, and there was just surface parking in front of it. That was done as a redevelopment project in which that became market rate lofts, and they rebuilt more senior housing behind it that was of a better quality, and then moved and got more senior housing on the other end of the streetcar. And then they built a whole strip of shops in front of it, so there's no dead zone on the street anymore. And that's our new depot, which became Maynard's Market and Maynard's Restaurant, which the guy who owned Hotel Congress jumped into that also. So I want to tell you a little bit about who I am and how I got to this position of being this streetcar godfather guy. I grew up in a suburb of Los Angeles, Ontario. This is my mom. She was Miss California in 1955. I did not get those genes. She's riding down Euclid Avenue, which is a really nice main street, and I got the sense that it had a real sense of history and its own urbanism. As the 70s went along, there's me and my sister playing Pong. Actually, it's an off-brand version of Pong because we didn't have that kind of money. That's the bicentennial bedspread. That would be 1976. And it became more of an L.A. suburb. And I watched it. I watched the parts I loved about its uniqueness and its history. I watched them get destroyed by urban sprawl. It really sort of launched itself into me. When I was going to school, we had smog alerts at least 10 times a year. We wouldn't be able to go outside and play because they were stage 3. It was bad, and I didn't want to be there. So I went back to Williams College in Williamstown for college, and I learned about preppies, which was a little bit shocking to me. My parents are both public school teachers, so I wasn't quite used to that. Those were my roommates. Yes, he was wearing red pants. It was an interesting other type of rural community. There was still a nice main street, and learned about that. But I got as far away from that as I could. By my junior year, I went to Cairo. These are my friends. That's Hassan and Sammy in the downtown marketplace, in the food marketplace. Hassan sold eggs. Sammy worked at a little shop next door. And I befriended them early, and I learned Arabic from them, and they learned English from me. And I learned a lot about local economies of at the real basic level and how people work together in a huge community. This was my apartment right across the Ministry of the Interior, so I saw a lot about that during the revolution recently. And I wrote a book, which I actually will have 10 copies at the dive deeper if you're interested in it, about the stories of the people in the downtown marketplace, which are fascinating because we don't really know about the in-depth, intimate stories of people who live in a completely foreign land that a lot of us are afraid of. And I wanted to be able to put that out there. So Cairo taught me a lot about cities. Then I moved to San Francisco, which taught me a lot more about cities. I lived there for 8 years. I was the art director for the San Francisco Bay Guardian newspaper. And I found out how cities really, really work in a multimodal way. Unfortunately, they worked so well in San Francisco, I couldn't afford to live there. So I went looking for somewhere else I could live and afford to live in to start my family, and I ended up going to Tucson. But when I went to Tucson, I was a little shocked because it was almost like going back to that sprawl I was trying to flee in LA. Lots of really big intersections, lots of really big streets, lots of cars, and nowhere for pedestrians. Early on, I discovered the pedestrians actually used to be here. These are some of those street photographs I was telling you about earlier. And this was the first book project I did. I worked with these low-income teenagers on the West Side and told a people's history from their perspective and those of their elders. And I found those photographs. And I invented a way for putting them on glazed ceramic tile in order to make them permanent when I hadn't done public art before, but a call to artists came out just after I'd done that project, and I wanted to do something with these photos. I just really wanted to do something with them. And they called for these walls were just in the eastern gateway to downtown Tucson where they were taken, so it was perfect. So I competed against a couple hundred other people from around the country who had lots of experience, but I invented that way for putting photos on tile, and I became a finalist, and then they picked me, even though I had no experience. So I'm very grateful to that committee for putting their trust in me. And there are 4,000 square foot of murals on the eastern boundary of downtown Tucson. Another one of the murals is a bus. You'll notice the Dr. Pepper thing on the top of the bus. Right there in the middle of the bus is the Dr. Pepper sign that I saw right outside here in the middle of downtown Roanoke. So there's another connection that's going out there. At the dedication, we closed off half of Broadway, built a stage. That's Bill Cote, who is one of the gentlemen there, that guy in the sunglasses on the right. All the people who are on the murals I chose, they came back for the dedication and talked about what it was like to be on the murals. Because I asked the public, send in these pictures. They weren't in any public archives. And I got 217 people coming in. So it was a hard time choosing, but I found all these great photographs. And that's why I did the book project also, because I wanted them to get published and send that out too. Anyway, Bill Cote was saying in that particular one that sometimes you wake up and you feel like you're 10 feet high. He never believed he'd ever feel like he was 18 feet high. And it was a huge success. People embraced it, and they started thinking about downtown differently. The mayor at the time in Tucson, Bob Walkup, who's a Republican, actually says now he thinks this was sort of the start of the downtown revitalization. sort of the art into streetcar thing. Now, I want to tell you that's me with a mustache. We started out looking into public transit, not because we started out intentionally trying to do it. I was on a citizens committee to look at the future of a corridor in Tucson called the 5th Sixth Street Corridor. And some engineer came up with a PowerPoint, and the title of that PowerPoint was Obstacles to Throughput. And the number one obstacle to throughput was pedestrians. So I turned to Clegg Van Slyke, who was a personal injury attorney, who was also a neighbor, and I said, is that the city we want to live in? And he said, no, let's do something about it. So then we talked to Gene Kaywood. Gene Kaywood is another amazing guy who founded an operating trolley museum, a historic trolley, that operated on Friday and Saturday nights in a one-mile stretch on 4th Avenue. And he was very interested. He knows everything there is to know about transit history, and he's also a transportation planner, so he knew a lot. And then Tony Haswell was retired to Tucson, but he's actually the guy that founded Amtrak. So he had a lot of knowledge about how to get things done. So we were sort of like this weird ragtag group, and then Joy Hercardillo came, and she was she's a public interest attorney, and she got interested in this stuff because she deals in environmental law, and she wanted that to happen. We'd gotten Ron Spark on board, who's a doctor. He was the head of the Pima County Medical Society, and he was a key guy in getting the smoking ban through in Arizona in public places. Bob Cook was a local economist who worked on energy issues, and he jumped in and actually provided us a fiscal agent. Nikki Pistachio worked for the Economic Development Agency and just knew how much this could do for our economy and jumped on board. And Camille Kirshner was just a bus rider who was really, really, really into having better transit. So she jumped on board and did all the sort of hard work we had to do. So we became the obstacles to the road builders' throughput. We started up with stuff, and since I'm a graphic designer, I started making pictures right away so people could see what we were talking about. So I put a San Diego light rail vehicle into a Tucson scene. We created a little logo, called ourselves Tucsonans for Sensible Transportation. And interestingly, just because we had our ideas and plans and pictures, that was enough for this magazine, Natural Health Magazine, to rate us the number 5 naturally healthy city in the country. Because the entire article is about our plans that were never accepted by the local government. So thank you, Tucson. And the next thing I wanted to do was give people an image of what our city could be like. So I created a real transit map as if we already had our system. And we built that one. I called it Tucson Link to give it a little more buzz. And then we started, and we fought a city road tax that would have starved transit in May 2002. But we didn't just fight against it. We also gathered signatures for our own alternative vision, our own plan, the Citizens Transportation Initiative. So we couldn't just say we were naysayers. We defeated the city plan, 69-31, and the next year we kept going and getting signatures. And one of the things we brought in to get signatures is I somehow managed to sweet-talk Bombardier, a company that builds light rail vehicles, to let us borrow one. And they brought it in, and those are the cranes putting it into the main library square downtown Tucson. The only thing was I had to be personally liable for anything that happened to it for a week. This is a $1.6 million vehicle. What we did actually is that we bribed the homeless guys with all the soda they could drink during the day to watch it at night, and it worked. It was really, really good. The problem was I actually got cranial shingles from the whole stress of the situation, so I ended up being locked up in my house for like a month until I got over that. But we got 18,000 signatures and got this on the ballot. And the city was really confused, upset, angry, because this wasn't coming from within the government. This was coming from a bunch of outsiders. And it's supposed to be a government-type project. And they would have to manage it. We lost our election because we didn't know what we were doing. And the home builders and the car dealers, they spent a bunch of money against us because they didn't like our funding source and they didn't know what I was talking about. But what I did the day after we lost, I looked at the precinct by precinct results and discovered that there was a large swath of the center city that supported us overwhelmingly. And I put a map on top of it of where the streetcar might go. And we started talking about a streetcar. And a week after the election, I rode on my bike over to the home builder's office and I talked with the CEO and I said, Ed, if we don't stop beating each other up, we'll never get anything done. So how about we figure out what we have in common and work together? And what we had in common was that we both agreed in transportation infrastructure was a good thing. And that started this process called the Regional Transportation Authority, where all sorts of people on opposite sides, neighborhoods, environmentalists, developers, business people, who used to fight all the time, all got together and said, let's get behind this. We had roads, we had more buses than was in my plan. We had more bikeways than was in my plan, and we had the modern streetcar in it.
I'm Steve Farley. Like many of you, I opposed the last government transportation plan. Together we voted no in large numbers. Believe it or not, our government listened. On May 16th, Pima County voters can vote yes on a great plan that is balanced and regional.
Those are my daughters.
Questions 1 and 2 will reduce congestion on our streets and revolutionize our public transit system. Former rivals are working together to support this plan, which will make life better for all of us. Vote yes on questions 1 and 2. This is the plan we've been waiting for.
So, I think a lot of people voted for it because they just wanted to save those poor kids. It was a long process in the community, and it was not at all certain we were going to get this done, because there was a lot of disagreement. They sat me next to the Chrysler dealer, who was a pretty big guy in town. His name was Steve Christie, and the first thing he said to me was, I hear we're both engineers. I said, I don't know what you mean. He said, well, I'm an automotive engineer, and you're a social engineer. So it actually went uphill from there. The first opening bid was $200 million for transit out of a $2 billion plan. And the county administrator was very powerful, was the guy who said that. I sort of subverted that by creating a subcommittee on transit, complete with the naysayers. And by the time that subcommittee was done, the guy that made the motion to increase it to $532 million for transit, including the streetcar, was Steve Christie, the Chrysler dealer. And we got it in. So we knew that was going to be important, so I jumped right into it. And even though there was plenty of naysayers and plenty of people, we'd lost five previous elections, and badly, over the last 30 years. No one ever thought we would be able to get an election to do any transportation in Tucson. But we won, 60-40, because we all came together and did this together. We basically, our opposition became part of what we did. And that's my daughter jumping in my arms. She was always looking for cameras on the celebration day. So they didn't always put the streetcar up front. There it is hiding down there because people were still worried. And we still needed to get a federal match in order to make this happen. This was just half the money we needed for the streetcar. And that's part of why the county administrator sort of went along with us doing, because he didn't think we'd ever get the federal match. But on February 2010, Secretary Ray LaHood came to town with a big check. $63 million, the biggest single Tiger grant the first year they were operated. And that's in large part thanks to my friends, Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords and Congressman Raul Grijalva. They did a lot of work in D.C., and people started to take up. Now we won that transportation election. It wasn't just me and my merry band of miscreants. It was a lot of people inside starting to understand how big this could be for the community, and it started to get embraced by people in government, although the county administrator was still angry. 2012, there's Aaron Napersteck, who you'll see later this afternoon, is the reason I'm here. My friend Aaron does Streets blog. And he came and did the groundbreaking. But you'll notice now by this time there's a switch. There's the secretary talking. There's the powers that be on the stage. They did the groundbreaking along with the construction people. And we were left out. So we did our own groundbreaking. We took up the shovels after they left and took a picture down there. And it was okay, because we knew. September 2013, we had a great community celebration. We had our first streetcar, and we dedicated the maintenance facility. It doesn't come without cost to do this sort of work. After the RTA election, somebody said to me, you know, you'd be pretty good at this professionally. So I decided maybe I should try, and there was a vacant seat in the legislature. I ran for the legislature, and then my first election, these hand-painted signs, but said things like that, and Farley heart taxes and things like that, were all over town. I won, it didn't matter, but people will try to attack you, right? The day after we won that monumental historic election that we'd never done before, this was the editor and publisher of the Afternoon Daily. He dedicated an entire story on the op-ed page to why my project was terrible and I was to blame. And it would never work. And it's a more horrible money pit, he was saying. His paper is now shut down, and we have a streetcar. This was a mailer that my opponent in 2012 actually mailed against me when I was running for state senate. And you'll notice I'm the streetcar godfather. I embraced that. I actually, when he went on and tried to pull that stuff on me on a television debate, I said, well, I'm glad you brought that up. I'm actually quite proud of being that. I was walking in the middle of the district, 15 miles from downtown. Downtown's not my district. So he thought it was to be a sure thing against me. 15 miles from downtown, I was walking door to door, and a guy came to the door. I started saying, I'm Steve Farley, I'm running for state senate. And he said, you're the streetcar guy, aren't you? And I started to explain to him, oh, yeah, this is why it's good. He was like, no. I just wanted to thank you, because you're the only reason I have a job. It was beautiful. It really happened. I didn't make that up. And he was working in the construction aspect of it. And there are so many jobs that are created in the construction, not just for the streetcar, but all the development that's happened around it. So it's wonderful as an opportunity. We had tried other stuff to do downtown. This was like the worst dead end. We created a transportation improvement, not a TIF district, in which we tax increment financing to try to spend a lot of money to put in a lot of fancy projects downtown. The fanciest one was some guy came in, an internationally renowned architect, decided he was going to build us a rainbow bridge over I-10. It was a floating science museum, and it would have cost $250 million. Well, it wasn't going to work. It was a terrible idea. It's a plop project instead of specific, and it never got built. Only $230 million got spent on virtually nothing downtown of that money. Virtually nothing, and nothing happened because of it. It's been slammed. It's become there's little doubt Rio Nuevo is the biggest failure in Tucson history. This was a quote from one of the news articles about it. So that didn't work. The big stuff didn't work, but infrastructure in the streetcar did. In 2001, there's a headline about the Arts District downtown, what downtown was like. What's supposed to be the city's cultural hub is a nest of bars, tattoo parlors, and empty storefronts, just like any other downtown. Now, 13 years later, it takes persistence. It's incredible. We've seen more than $1.5 billion within three blocks of a four-mile route. It's amazing, the transformation, the jobs, and the economy, and the life on the street and how the community comes together. Margot Susco owned a shop called Hydra. She was one of the biggest. She put these big signs in her window, how much she was hating it, and said it was a total waste of taxpayer dollars in the article at that time. Then they do a new article about her after the streetcar is open. Her business has tripled since the streetcar opened. She's now the biggest booster. These things have been happening. The business has gone up everywhere along the way. Here's some of the naysayers on ridership. I estimate it'll be useful for 200 people. Another guy gave as an absurd anxiety. Imagine, we would only pay for itself if it had 3,400 people. Well, we now have an average of 5,500 people and an average weekday ridership. We had 60,000, more than the Silver Line in D.C. on the first week of operations, which was the same weekend as the Silver Line opened. So it's been tremendously, incredibly well received. And I want to hear this little blurb on conservative talk radio.
790-24 is the phone number. This is your shot to talk to Captain Streetcar.
That's here, right.
For a whole hour. Anything you want to hit Steve on, whether it's streetcar or otherwise. Let's go to Tia Gloria. What's up?
They like to hit me.
Hey.
Hello.
I don't know if you know that I do not drive. And I can get some exercise. I'm getting 10,000 steps a day, but I'm also riding the streetcar. And I take my books to the library, pick up new ones. Perry Stuhler's down there. I got a new battery in my watch.
You're still wearing a watch.
Yes. There's Desert Rose Boutique, where they have the most glorious shoes and clothing and jewelry. And lunch anywhere I want. And today, we're going to take one of our neighbors. She's lived in this neighborhood 60 years. And she's never been on the streetcar, so she's all excited. I'm going to go down to get my hair done at right behind Delectables, Christopher. What is
Metropolis?
Yeah, Metropolis. Yes, thanks to your show, I'm going to go take the streetcar to
this
Metropolis.
This is conservative hate radio.
I've ridden the streetcar in lots and lots of places, including several times in New York City. And so, let me tell you the difference on this one. Everyone visits. Perfect strangers strike up conversations and visit the whole way. And it's not just me who I'll talk to door post, you know. But, I mean, everyone is in a chatty mood.
It seems like everyone's a little happier on the streetcar than they are on the SunTran.
So that sums it up to me. Is it really... all that economic stuff is amazing. It's incredible for the community. It's transformative. But it's the community sense of itself. This is just some pictures during testing. Skater boys feel comfortable near it. I got in trouble telling a reporter on video that it feels like a majestic whale to me, living among us. Because it's silent and graceful and beautiful, and we just feel comfortable with it. The hate radio did a lot with that one. But it's about how people feel about themselves in the community. They really are. This is the dedication day. You know, notice this is the same thing. In fact, there's the back. I'll show you that one. It's helpful to be a graphic designer. You get the stuff done for free by yourself. And I actually have 20 of these that I'll be able to get at the Dive Deep tomorrow. If you want to pay what you think with it, because all the money from our nonprofit Friends of the Tucson Streetcar goes to buying stored value cars to give free to people so that they use more transit in Tucson. So there's that. And this was just some of the dedication stuff. It was just an incredible event. It was 115 degrees. That's the temperature on my Prius there. But 60,000 people came downtown. And I cannot tell you the feeling that day of how amazing it was. People were talking with everyone else they didn't know. Everyone was walking a little more spring in their step and walking a little more upright, and people were saying, we're a real city now. And it just gave us a different sense of ourselves. I loved this little kid. The little kids were amazing. The way that they responded to the streetcar and they were going on there. That's us. We gave away 1,000 stored value cards that weekend. We gathered corporate money and then spent them on transit passes. I love the Robin Hood stuff. That longboarder guy, the woman next to him, the senior, was sort of getting, it was hard for her to hand on, so he offered his longboard to hold on to so she would stay steady. And people in wheelchairs, we got little ramps that come out. They were equalized with everyone else. They don't have to have the big lift like on the bus where they got to make everyone wait. They're just on and off, and it's an equalizer for all of them. We had all sorts of parties around town. This was in the Mercado District on the west side. This is something that happens along the streetcar route. It's one of the biggest processions in the country. We have 50,000 people in our All Souls procession on the day of the Day of the Dead, and people come from all over the country for it. We have fire trapeze and all sorts of things along it. And this is the streetcar underpass they're going through. Everyone really honors those who have died the previous year that they're close to, and we all sort of mourn together as a community. On the west side, this whole area that was the garbage dump is now in Mercado, where they have a community commercial kitchen that people can use to do stuff. There's business incubators in here. We have a farmer's market. There's the streetcar stop is right there. There's a new, that was a food truck that made their own new place right there next to the farmer's market and the streetcar stop. It's been a tremendous on the west side because it's putting a lot of money into what has been an impoverished part of town and made it work. This was the interns at the Morning Daily came with the idea of wanting to decorate Twinkies to look like streetcars on the opening weekend. So this was them doing that. And there's my artwork right there on one corner of the streetcar line. So I like seeing both my pieces of public art in the same picture. This is a really expensive piece of public art right there. And this was another little thing I wanted to mention, is that tiki head is now a major monument on 4th Avenue, but it used to be at a miniature golf place out on the east in the Sprawling area. And my daughters loved that miniature golf course. I loved it too because they were all sort of homemade by this guy who did real crafty things. And a car dealer bought it, was going to plow it all and make it into a parking lot and destroy it all. So I convinced him to wait, and we had an event where we had one last round of golf there that lasted for an entire day, and we raised enough money to move all the statues to new homes. And this one is now on the 4th, there's a streetcar there. It's now a symbol of 4th Avenue. And I love little stuff like that matters, as we keep hearing all the time. So it's changed our community and what we feel like about ourselves. And we really, this was a community that was really alone in our cars. And now we're together in our streetcar. And there's the rest. There's the crazy ragtag bunch that started this whole crazy idea when they were throwing stuff against us. That's right after our first ride. We got a preview ride. And this was, there was the first electric streetcar on June 1st, 1906. And there's July 25th, 2014 as the new electric streetcar comes out. So that's it for my presentation. We have like 5 minutes for questions, I think, or a little more than that, or however it works. if you'd like to have any of them. So I'm just so excited to share this with you, and come visit Tucson because it's really fun. I'll give you a personal tour.
Thanks so much.